Welcome to another Diz Explorers episode. So this week, we're going to talk about some movies. Specifically, Pixar movies. We're going to go around our round table of sorts, and everyone's going to kind of talk about their top three favorite Pixar movies, and then we'll discuss. We'll argue. We'll say each one will say how everyone is, the other one is wrong. The only rule we have is that Cars 2 cannot be on anybody's list. That's grounds for expulsion from Disney fandom altogether.
Agreed.
So, just going to introduce everyone real quick so we know what the voice is, and I hope you know who we are by now anyway, but... So, we have Adrian.
Hello.
And Jessica.
Hey, everybody.
And Melanie.
Hi there.
And Mr. Milford.
Hello.
And I am RJ. In the interest of who I know is prepared the most, Adrian, you can go first.
You would be surprised, actually. I totally went with my gut on this one. Discussed it a little bit with my husband, trying to see what he would think would be my favorites. And I had to go with, and these are in no particular order, by the way. I can't rank them. But the top of my list, I think, would have to be Toy Story. I know a lot of people go for Toy Story 3, which I'm sure is on somebody's list at some point. But no. but I love an origin story. I love a beginning, especially when there are several in a series. If you were to ask me my favorite Star Wars, it's A New Hope, which goes against everything everybody else says. But I do. I just love a beginning. I love introductions. I love getting to know characters and all of that. So it's kind of, you know, the OG of Pixar anyway. So Toy Story is definitely on there. Then I went with The Incredibles. I love The Incredibles, and nice. if you don't love Frozone, there's something wrong with you.
Yes, totally.
That
right?
Is my super suit.
Exactly. If you, I can't think of anybody who couldn't love that. It's just hilarious.
Mm-hmm.
And then a newer one, but still, and this one might be a little controversial, Finding Dory. As opposed to Finding Nemo, which goes against everything I just said about liking origin stories better. Maybe it's just because it's more recent in my brain. I don't know. We've been watching Finding Dory around my house a lot in the past few months, but I love it. I love Ellen. Ellen is perfect for that role. I loved her in Finding Nemo, and given a bigger role, I think, here in Finding Dory was just fun. I love that Sigourney Weaver is in there, you know, as the voice in her little aquarium, for those who haven't seen it. And I just love everything about it. And then you think you've reached the climax of the movie, and then there's another hilarious 30 minutes afterward. So it's just, I love it. I could go on about that one for a long time, but I love Finding Dory.
That movie surprised me in more ways than one. Yeah, that whole ending sequence thing, like after they escape, it's just freaking ridiculous.
And and I remember what I was going to say about that while I was thinking about it. For those that don't know, in like my non-Disney life, I'm a speech therapist, and I worked for about 10 years with special needs children. So I love the fact that that movie so subtly, everybody in there has something that makes them kind of special and different. You know, Dory has her short-term memory loss, but then there's the beluga whale who can't use his sonar, and there's the short-sighted, right?
Yep.
Short-sighted, nearsighted, I can't remember, whale, uh-huh. And then there's the octopus with only seven legs.
Yep.
I mean, everything. I love it. So.
And then there was Beck. And then there was Becky.
Right. Bless. I've worked with a few Beckys. I'm just saying. But I love it. I love it.
I'll have to say before we move on, that movie was. I don't think it could have been cast any better either. That the actors and actresses that they chose for the new characters that were involved in that movie were spot on. Because I can't picture anybody else but Ed O'Neill being Hank, because that was just friggin' perfect. I mean, just and Ty Burrell for the the other whale, and then fantastic casting.
Yeah, it was. Which is always top notch in Pixar films, typically. But
yeah, definitely.
They definitely hit it out of the park with that one.
Absolutely. Okay, let's see. Round and round we go. Where do we stop? Jessica.
All right. So for my number three, I actually went with Toy Story 2 and not Story 3. Just because I really liked the added dynamic when Jesse and Bullseye and Prospector showed up. I just thought it kind of added an interesting dynamic to the existing group. And the reason I didn't pick Toy Story 3 is because it makes me cry, and that can't be one of my favorites.
Right.
Yeah, it came out right before I graduated from high school, so Andy moving out of his room, my mom and I were just sobbing in the theater. It was really embarrassing. And then number two, I picked Monsters, Inc., because Mike and Sully, I came out when I was, I think, 12, and we went to see it 3 or 4 times in the theater. My brother and I just kept dragging my mom back, and it wasn't long before we knew all the lines to that movie. So I still think it's funny now, but it ranks so high for me mostly because of how I reacted to it as a kid. But then my favorite Pixar movie is The Incredibles, and I realize I like it because of the characters more so than the plot, because I just find all the characters and the way they interact really interesting. I think they did a really good job of making them a believable family with the dynamics. And I actually read somewhere that their superpowers are all based on family stereotypes, which I didn't realize. So
I
like
can
Mr.
Totally
Incredible.
See that.
Yeah, Mr. Incredible is supposed to be the big protector, so he has super strength. Elastigirl is supposed to be everywhere at once as a mom, so she has the stretching power. You know, the teenager who's really shy has invisibility. And then the little kid that has so much energy can run really fast. And then the baby, I guess, is supposed to be destructive, and he doesn't really know who he is yet, which is why he also changes shape so much.
Damn,
so
that's just like my family. Without the superpowers. Wow, that's pretty cool. I never would have thought of that.
Yeah, I didn't either, but I watched it after reading that, and it gave me a whole new perspective, and I kind of appreciated the way that they subtly put that in there. They didn't say anything about why Frozone has his powers or why Edna is so fabulous, but
well, Edna, you know,
Edna is
the voice casting in that one was really good too.
Yes. Anything with Samuel L. Jackson is just fantastic, whether he gets to curse or not.
I totally agree.
I've heard people who have added in the, made Frozone like Jules from Pulp Fiction, and it's pretty funny.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
This is wrong.
You can just imagine. You can just imagine it in your head. Alrighty. So, all right, Melanie, what do you got?
All right. Now, my one and two was so easy that it made three kind of It was hard for me to pick a number three because there are a lot that kind of fall in there. But for number three, I'm going to go out there, and it's not because the story was so endearing or loving, but because it was such a unique film. And I'm going to go with WALL-E for my number three.
Oh, that's my mom's favorite.
The social commentary is scathing, which I love. How they show corporations taking over, the floating scooter people sucking down their, supersized Slurpees, how we destroyed the environment and destroyed it so much that we couldn't live here anymore. The social commentary is just spot on. And that they even managed to kind of have a robotic love story interweaved into all of that. You gotta kind of like it.
I love it. And there's that message of hope, too, when he finds the plant. And mm-hmm. I love it. Now,
even though the mechanisms were in place for that to signal the return to Earth, there were still some who, you know, were fighting it. You know, it still didn't go as easily as planned. So I'm going to go with Wally for my number three. For my number two, it's got to be Up.
Oh, see, that one makes me cry. That's why it's not on my list.
I love the Wilderness Explorers. I love Doug. I just met you, and I love you. Anybody with a dog knows that that is just how they are. And, you know, with the tennis balls, for my mine, it's squirrels. Squirrel. You know, I could probably wake up my dog right now by going, squirrel.
Yeah.
I can't. She was sound asleep.
It works.
It works. I love how, you know, how they formed their bond, and, you know, it's just a nice story, even when they do have to deal with, what is the bad guy's name? I'm drawing a blank now.
Oh, I can't remember either.
Gosh, of course I have a blank right now.
Professor something or other.
Yeah, and he has to go and
I
find
can't think
the
of
Kevin.
His name. Yeah.
And I love that Kevin, he's a mom. I have a son named Kevin, so that was, you know, a good source of humor in our household for a while. But, you know, so it's just so endearing, and it's just one of my favorites. And I did bawl like a baby at the very beginning. I just think you got a good cry out of the way.
Yeah.
In fact, it was the very first movie we ever owned on Blu-ray. When we finally got our first Blu-ray player. Up was the first movie we played, and we were blown away by it visually. It's a great one, and it's not going to be any surprise that my number one is The Incredibles as well. I think that one is making the tops of all of our lists for good reason, and the only reason that that movie is as awesome as it is the one and only Edna Mode. She
Life
is
coach.
Fabulous. I absolutely love Edna, darling. And when my kids found out that Brad Bird was the one who did the voicing for her, they were like, oh. So I love it. It's too much gobble gobble, too much talk.
I have to say, the other day we were watching something on Supernatural and a commercial for Supergirl came on. And I was talking to my husband. I was like, you know, I never got into Superman or Supergirl, and I was trying to figure out why, and then it hit me. Capes.
Yeah. No capes.
No capes. But, and of course, Frozone. I'm hoping, I'm kind of against, as much as, obviously, this is my number one Pixar movie. I am scared to death of this sequel that's coming.
Yeah, me too.
Up my favorite Pixar movie, I'm going to be mad.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. I hope, though, one of my hopes, other than, of course, getting to see more Edna, because she needs to be the John Ratzenberger. You need to put Edna in every movie, kind of like the A113 or the John Ratzenberger character yep. or the Pizza Planet truck. We should have Edna Mode in every movie. There's got to be a place
idea.
For it. But I want to meet Honey.
Yes.
We have to meet Honey.
Yep.
That's one thing I want to see. Because anybody who could be married to Frozone, she's got to be all right by me.
Yeah, I want to see them have a dinner or go to the grocery store or just interact more.
Something. Maybe go to a PTO meeting.
Anything. Bowling.
So I do want to see that. But just the mix of the family dynamic versus that midlife crisis, because I'm in my 40s. Mr. Incredible is about my husband's age. He's in his 40s. So we get that whole family dynamic. We're like smack dab in the middle of that family dynamic right now. And that's why it was kind of my favorite. I know what it's like to be stretched super thin, where you're like, you've got one hand over here grabbing one kid, one hand over here grabbing another. And heck, we've got three kids, so there goes my slit. So I feel Elastigirl's pain. I really do. And, you know, just trying to remember what you are outside of being that mom. So when Edna Mode, you know, when Elastigirl is having her little identity crisis because her husband has gone off to the island, and Edna's like, pull yourself together. You are Elastigirl. You know, she has to remind her who she is, because as moms, we forget. We totally forget who we are, because we're stuck in PTO. We're in carpool. We've got one kid in this sport, one kid playing this instrument and doing all this other thing. And you forget, okay, wait a minute. I was kind of awesome before I started all this. I'm still awesome, but I was awesome on my own as well. And you forget that. So when Edna Mode is giving her her pep talk, you're like, yeah, I am that person. And, you know, I'm still that person. So I love how, you know, Edna Mode just pulls them all together. I mean, everybody should have an Edna Mode in their life. And so I hope, you know, everybody does, because she really is that voice of support, even if it comes harshly. I like to call it stylish tough love that she provides. But yeah, I mean, in the kids, how they struggle with, can I be a super? Can I not be a super? Can I use what I have inside me? You know, how do I grow with that? And then I just like that Jack blows up into balls of flame. That's kind of awesome.
Yeah, you can't go wrong with that.
And let's not forget Syndrome ringing the doorbell with the big S on his chest. He's like, I'm the sitter. I was going to put BS there, but we can see how that would go. I was like, oh no. So the adult humor, spot on. So that's why Incredibles is my number one.
Cool. All right, Milford, you're up.
All right, I'm going to go kind of off the beaten path here. I'd have to say my number three is Inside Out.
Ah, interesting.
And
that one was close.
Yeah, that was close.
Because all the interactions between the different emotions, and especially the scene where they're all at the kitchen table when the husband and the wife are, their two brains are kind of going at it. And
fabulous.
That whole thing. Exactly. I mean, that's real life. I'm sorry.
Well,
and it has a tie-in to Disney World, too, because it kind of reminds me of Cranium Command.
Yes.
From the
Wonders of Life.
Wonders of Life Pavilion. Thank you. I couldn't think of the name of it. So that I really liked that movie. I actually sat through that whole movie.
And the end credits of that movie is the best thing I've ever seen.
Yes. Yeah. Yep.
The cats? Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
I can't even.
I know. That is funny. All the dads had that big giant mustache in this brain.
I know.
Yeah. And then my number two, believe it or not, is The Incredibles. Not number one, number two. And pretty much, I'm not going to rehash everything you guys have talked about. It's got so many great things in it. And I'm a superhero guy. So, you know, I love superheroes, so The Incredibles was just awesome. My number one, you guys are going to probably laugh, but I like A Bug's Life. I thought it was a good movie. It had the whole good guy, bad guy thing with Hopper and the you know, they got to get the seeds for the grasshoppers and all that stuff, so... It was just kind of cool. Plus, it was one of the first couple Pixar movies too. So,
I do like that the ladybug was not a lady.
That's right.
Yes, Francis. That was hilarious.
Francis.
Yes.
Yeah, Bug's Life.
And then, you know, like down to them building the contraption that looks like a bird to scare the grasshoppers away and all that stuff. So, and again, tie to the attraction at Animal Kingdom, because I believe it or not, I actually like the Bug's Life thing in the Tree of Life.
Oh, I do too.
I think it's one of the best shows at Animal Kingdom.
It's great to be in there with first timers. It's fantastic.
Oh, yeah, when they don't expect anything.
When they don't know what the hell is going on, it's great.
Oh, man.
And that animatronic Hopper is friggin' fantastic. That's a pretty good animatronic.
Yes. Yeah. So that's my top three.
Cool. All right. Well, I guess it's my turn. So I, like Adrian, don't have a particular order for any of these. I think they're all pretty equal. So I'm just going to run them down how I jotted them down. I think I'll leave the one that hasn't been mentioned yet for last, just in the interest, because then I can elaborate on it. So Incredibles was definitely on my list. That was the first one I wrote down when we first were going to discuss this topic, and pretty much for all the reasons that everybody has said. Other than that, I just enjoy it. I look more at the comedic end of movies other than the more thought-out things that Melanie had talked about and that had Jessica had mentioned with the superpowers actually meant. I just like the comedy and the interaction between everything and between the family, the brother and sister fighting and then having to figure out how to work as a team, but then they're still fighting and then the mother's still telling them they weren't supposed to jump out of the plane, but they jumped out of the plane anyway and helped her and the whole snuck onto the plane, I mean, and the whole thing. And, you know, Mr. Incredible trying to relive his glory days and with a buddy of his, because I can speak from that firsthand. I'm not a superhero, but, you know, I like to relive my glory days from when I was, you know, not having to worry about shuttling kids all over the place and responsibility and getting up to go to work every day and things along that line. So I definitely can relate to that aspect of it as well. And the John Ratzenberger effect, which is probably my favorite part of any Pixar movie, seeing where he's going to pop up and what they're going to stick him in. So, you know, he was at the end of this, of Incredibles.
Yeah, he didn't come until the very end.
As the little mole guy. So, you know, that's pretty cool. I'm, I guess, cautiously optimistic for what this new one is going to be. I just hope it's not a train wreck like most of the number twos have been that Pixar has put out. I'm just hoping for a halfway decent story with good characters, and I think I'll be happy. We'll leave it at that. My next one on my list was Toy Story 2. Well, I do like the first one for all the reasons that Adrian had mentioned, being in an origin story, and it is the first one where it introduces everybody. And Buzz Lightyear is probably my favorite Disney character of all. So, but Toy Story 2, I think, is more special to me because that's the one my son took to more, my firstborn, and that was the one that was on constant rotation in my house. So I knew that one more back to front than I knew the first one. And that opening scene with Buzz Lightyear, where it's, you know, ends up being Rex playing the video game, I think is like the best intro to a movie ever, other than what they did for Toy Story 3, where they recreated the entire scene from the first one that Andy was pretending to play in his room with the train and the, you know, I've got my force field dog and I have my dinosaur. That is probably the greatest beginning to a movie ever created ever by any movie, live action or animated.
Here.
Hands down. And I don't care what anybody says, I'm right. On that one. You can't tell me how awesome it was to see, if you went and saw it in the theater, to watch that whole scene. And having seen the first movies probably as many times as those of us who are parents have seen those movies and be like, are you friggin' kidding me? They actually did this. Because that was the friggin' most awesome thing ever.
I like the Woody's Roundup. The whole old style show.
Yes. Yeah, I did too.
I like Woody's backstory. It's almost like Woody's kind of origin was really before we knew his origin.
Oh, no doubt. Definitely. And the whole thing with Jessie and how, you know, she was kind of abandoned. And yeah, I like that. I like the new characters being in. And that movie is just, to me, I just like it better than the original. And then for my third one on the list, I have Cars.
That was close to my list, too.
And that is for a similar reason as Toy Story 2. That movie came out in 2005, which is when my oldest was born. So he didn't end up watching it until he was a couple of years old. But that movie became second on rotation only to Toy Story 2. And I knew that movie back to front. I'm pretty sure if I tried, I can still recite most of it. And I would laugh every time. I would laugh every time. From the opening scene with the song, with the RV that jumps out, you know, for the huh part of it, and the Elvis RV. I mean, there's so much in that movie to see. And the storyline I thought was great. I think my favorite scene in that movie is when they light up all the neon lights for Radiator Springs and they're, you know, rolling down the street like at an old cruise, like from the 50s with the neon lights and the old cars. And
it's just beautiful.
It's just gorgeous.
That scene was the first thing that I thought of, too.
Yeah. And, you know, I'm into old cars. I have an old car, so it hits home for in that respect. And just the whole thing and the whole decision that Lightning had to make with, you know, fighting back and forth and meeting these whole people who actually accepted him for how he was versus how he thought he was perceived in the world that he dominated. And just the whole thing, just from beginning to end, is just fantastic. The ride that him and Sally take, you know, I like the soundtrack, not only the popular songs, but the score of the movie is fantastic if you have, like, the full soundtrack. It's just, you know, and that whole story about the little motel that was up there. And so it was just such a well done movie, and the fact that it held my kids' attention all the time constantly made it even better, and it made it that much worse when the piece of crap that came out that they build as Cars 2 afterwards that it could have went from one to extreme to the other, and then that one, and that actually got green lighted as it was and put into full production, because what a hot mess that thing was. So those were my three, and I'm glad we all had different ones. The only repeat was The Incredibles. 5 out of the 6 of us had that on their list. Everything else was, other than Toy Story 2, everything else was only picked once by one of us, which I think is great. And I
struggled with not picking Toy Story 2. Because my kids love that one as well. In fact, one of the things we liked about it, and I wanted to know if your son did as well, did you guys ever have the Woody's Roundup CD by Riders in the Sky?
I have it now, but I don't think I had it then.
Yeah, we probably broke a couple of them because we played them so much.
So much, yeah.
They had Riders in the Sky is a wonderful rockabilly cowboy kind of band. I don't know exactly the genre. They're not country.
No, that's it. You pretty much got it.
Rockabilly kind of cowboy. But they have a version of Act Naturally, the old Buck Owens song that the Beatles did it too. It's so good. So if you've got any kids who are into Toy Story, I definitely recommend, you know, going over to iTunes and getting the Woody's Roundup DVD.
Yeah, definitely.
It's a different take on Disney music. And they've got the Jesse the Yodeling Cowgirl song, and they do have their version of You've Got a Friend in Me.
Mm-hmm.
I won't say whether or not my kids tried to do the yodel song. That would be embarrassing for them. Not so much me.
No.
Not so much me. But it is a good... The music is sound, and I say that with all of my heart on that one, because the music was just so well done. It just speaks to the fact that in the early days of Pixar, every character had a backstory. I'm sure Rex has a backstory. Ham has a backstory.
Oh yeah, no doubt.
There's no character or no piece of scenery that's just put in there willy-nilly. Everything was so well thought out. So, you know, those of us who are fans of the old school Pixar, when we get a Cars 2, we're like, what the what?
Yeah.
What is this nonsense?
Right.
Because you can feel the heart that was put into the Toy Story 1 and then the Toy Story 2 and how they fought doing Toy Story 2 because they didn't want Pixar to be a sequel machine.
Right.
But the backstory was just there because those characters were so well developed.
Oh, yeah.
That Toy Story 2 was a no-brainer.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, come on, Spanish-speaking Buzz Lightyear.
Oh, in Toy Story 3, yeah. Oh, definitely. Oh,
that
without
was
a doubt.
Toy Story 2.
Yeah, that was brilliant.
Too. Yeah. Oh my goodness. Hi, Dad. And so we meet Buzz Lightyear's dad, and
I know,
all that good stuff. It's spoiler alert.
I know. Yeah, that
and
whole.
How that car... It's, the characters were so well done back in the day, so, you know, we had come to expect that. So when we see some of these Cars 3 or Monsters University thrown at us, we're like, what? And I think they broke that trend with Finding Dory.
Yes.
I think they did a good job with character development. It wasn't in my top three, probably not even in my top five, but it was good. I enjoyed it, and that's high praise for me. So
yeah, definitely. I'll agree with that.
I think they broke the sequel curse.
Yes.
With Finding Dory. I still prefer Finding Nemo because I think Finding Dory kind of became Toy Story for fish, but I like the characters.
So I tell you, it was a toss-up for me between Cars and Finding Nemo because that was the other one that was popular with both of my older two. My little guy doesn't really sit much for movies, but...
But yeah, so we love Finding Dory. That was, you know, my kids were toddlers when Finding Dory came out. So yep. It was in pretty heavy rotation, you know. I will say there was probably one day where I watched it four times.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm sitting there cooking dinner, you know, going, excuse me.
Yeah, but tell me this, because the same thing happened with me with Cars and Toy Story 2. It was on so many times, and I would always say, oh, buddy, you're watching this again? You want to try a different one? Let's put a different one in. No, buzz, buzz, buzz. Or lightning. I'd sit, maybe not watching the thing in its entirety every time, but I'd sit down and watch it every freaking time. I don't care, like you said, if it was on, like on a Saturday when we were home, literally it was on from the time he woke up through the time, you know, up till nap time and then till bedtime. So, you know, Cars is like a two-hour movie, so... divide that into however many hours he's up during the day, four or five times in a day.
Yeah.
and I'd watch it every time.
Is that they stand up because you start noticing those nuances. Because when you are a parent who has to watch this movie three times a day for like two or three or 4 months.
Yeah. Years.
It's everything. And you delight when you discover something new. Like, oh, I didn't realize that was like that. Or you find the Easter eggs. Or you see, you know, a character nuance that you never noticed before, but you know was put in there intentionally.
Yeah.
And that added so much to the depth of the characters. Because when you watch those movies so many times.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
When you realize, like with Toy Story 1, that you've got a friend in me song. I remember when it hit me like a bag of bricks. Because at the beginning of Toy Story 1, you've got a friend in me. That's Woody and Andy.
Yep.
By the end of the movie, you've got a friend in me is Buzz and Woody.
Yep.
And I remember when it hit me that that song meant two different things at the beginning of the movie and at the end of the movie. And I'm like, man, these people know what they're doing.
Yep. And it's...
You know, they understand story and story arc and character development. And then... when you've gotten some of the more recent titles that haven't kind of hit those home runs.
Well, it's the little jokes that they throw in for adults every once in a while. Now, they're not vulgar. They're not sexual in any way. But it's like in Toy Story 2, for instance, the part that cracked me up the most, the stuff during the movie. But at the end, one of my favorite gags was when they're all together in Andy's room and it's new toys and you know, Andy's written his name on Bullseye and everything else. And Slinky Dog comes out and says, you know, hey, this, you know, the critters, he's got an emergency here. And Jesse goes and flips on the skateboard and goes through the racetrack and opens the door for the dog and Buzz's wings pop out and his, like, jaws dropped and everything. That slays me every time. My kids were looking, what the hell's so funny? I was like, you'll understand when you're older. But, you know, Buzz is impressed, or if you know what I mean. So, and then there's...
very clever humor.
Yeah, and then in Cars, and I just laugh because Larry the Cable Guy did a perfect job with Mater. He couldn't have picked a better person other than maybe Jeff Foxworthy, but his voice probably wouldn't have panned out. But when Lightning finds all the trophies in the garage and he comes out and he's like, did you know Doc won 3 Piston Cups? And Mater's like, he did what in his cup? It's like, and I would just, on the floor... laughing every time. My wife was like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, how do you not think that's funny? I was like, it sounds like he's saying he pissed in his cup. That's what he's trying to say. That's what he's, you know, so if I have to explain it, it's not funny, you know. And the kids were like, you know, they're 5 and 6 year old, they're like, huh, you know, they laugh because I laugh, but they didn't, you know, they don't get it. Now they do because they're, you know, almost teenagers. But, you know, it's the stuff like that that I appreciate, because that keeps me wanting to watch it a million times.
And I know we weren't going to talk about the shorts or anything, but the Mater's Tall Tales is the cutest thing I've ever seen.
Those were the best.
I love it.
Those were the best. I had a bunch of them recorded, like, on the DVR for the longest time, but then we ended
They're on Netflix.
Are they really?
Yes.
Because I liked, like, the monster truck one, the wrestling one.
Yes, they're all fabulous.
And worse beyond that was the merchandising behind the Cars movie, because they made a car for every single one of those characters, and I had to buy all of them.
And they have lightning in every conceivable color.
Yeah, and I have all
those are all in my son's drawer right now.
Yeah, I went as far as, because we have a Stop and Shop where I am up in Connecticut, and the Super Stop and Shop, the big giant one that has freaking everything in it, would have all of them. So I have all the regular characters, and these were die-cast cars, and that's why I was buying them at like $5 a pop. Every week I would go, I'd come home, oh, I got a car for Rocco. My wife would be like, no, you didn't. You got it for you. You're not even going to let him touch it. But I have, like, because they did little shorts where they turned other characters from Pixar movies into cars. So I have a Buzz Lightyear car, a Woody one. I have the Yeti as a monster truck. I have, you know, and then I have the main characters, Luigi and Guido and all of them, you know, Doc Hudson, every single one of them. But I have, like, the weird ones. I have Mike and Sully, because at the end of that movie, right? At the end of the movie, they had them. There was at the end of one of them where they had them all as cars, and I can't think of which one it was.
I remember that.
Yeah, I have Mike and Sully as Cars characters. I think I have a monorail. It was insane. It was the amount of money I spent on these flipping things, and now they're all banged up and scratched up in my third child's bin, and I've slowly been stealing them back and putting them in my little display case, because now I just don't want them to get wrecked, because you can't find them anywhere. And I just bought, and they still make, I still look when I go to this, and I just found, because they didn't make it back then, I have Frank, the Harvester. I paid $8 for the thing, because it's a bigger scale size thing, but I was like, oh my god, I have a couple of little tractors, but I never had, like, I've never seen that one before. I was like, holy crap, I need to have this.
Okay, genius was tipping tractors.
Oh my gosh.
Yep. Oh man.
Okay, I grew up pretty redneck, but we never actually tipped cows, just so you know, but we knew what it was.
I'm not judging.
But I can tell you also, I got some redneck stories for y'all if y'all need them. But
I'm pleading the fifth.
that scene now, you know.
But yeah, so tipping those tractors was so funny. Tractors is stupid.
Tipping the tractors and then making the sound that they made afterwards.
They fart
them
at
farting
the end.
Afterwards. Because farts are funny. I don't care who you are. And they run rampant in my family. So watching that movie with my father.
God,
was just,
what?
I mean, we were, you want to talk about in the tears, laughing on the floor. It's just like riotous, and all the women not understanding why it's so funny.
In the Radiator Springs Racers Ride in Cars Land, there's a whole scene with the tractor tipping.
Yes.
Oh, I can't wait.
It's worth it. Just to see that.
Absolutely. Okay.
I can't wait to see Cars Land at night.
Yeah, it's amazing.
I can't wait.
I'm going to make sure I get to do that.
Definitely. Okay, well, so that's our lists. That's what we think. So let us know, everybody out there on the old social media machines. Give us a tweet. Check us on Facebook. Let us know what your Pixar movies are. We're more than happy to discuss or argue any of that. So, thank you all for coming along with us on this little movie journey of our favorite movies. We appreciate it. We thank you for listening. As always, you can go check us out on thedizexplorers.com. That is our website, where you can find links on there to all our social media accounts on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. And you can also find all of our troopers' individual social media accounts, where you can go and follow along with the fun, along with all of us, as well as the host account for the Diz Explorers, which we hope you all do, because we are a lot of fun, and you just don't know it yet, so. And for those of you who do follow along, you do know how much fun it is, and we thank you for that. So until next time, we thank you for listening, and we'll talk to everybody later. The way I do. Just me and you, babe. And as the
days go by. Our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend.